Good morning.
Good morning.
You have your Bibles open to the book of Exodus. We're going to start in Exodus today. So today is Palm Sunday. I apologize through a lack of logistics, a failure in logistics. We have no palm branches here. So imagine, if you will, palm branches, decorated however you would like. God has been taking me through a journey that has actually started. Honestly, I can't tell you when it started, but I only became aware of it several years ago. And this journey has been understanding that as Western thinkers, as Greek thinkers, we miss a lot of what is going on in Scripture. Because Scripture was written in and to, at that time, Eastern thinkers. We see a demonstration, an example of this, when Paul is writing to the Corinthians, and he says that the Jews ask for a sign, and the Greeks look for wisdom. And that really is kind of the difference between the types of thinking that is so prevalent today. One of the things that God has been taking me through on this journey is that His Word is much, much richer than I will ever be able to fully grasp. And each time I read something and God gives me something new, I'm amazed. How did I miss this? How did I not see this before? And I think that's good, because if you were to give it to me all at once, my head would explode. And yours would explode too. And I appreciate the things that He's done. But one of the things that we need to understand and we need to grasp is that the Scripture carries within it a unique Jewishness. Now, I don't know why God chose who and why He did. He didn't really find it necessary for me to understand the depth of His thinking, probably because I wouldn't be able to. But God, for whatever reason, He chose Abraham. And from Abraham, and through Isaac and Jacob and the patriarchs, he chose for Himself a people through whom He might reveal Himself to the world. Okay? That's not to say that God was not working in other people. We know that He was. Because Abraham, the one that God chose right at the start there, he bows and he offers tithes to Melchizedek, who is not of the line of Abraham. So we know God was working in the world outside of Abraham. But for whatever reason, God chose Abraham that through him, he could reveal Himself to the world. Okay? Now that carries with it an understanding that we miss a lot of times, because we are very egocentric in our thinking. Okay? Not egotistical, although perhaps we're egotistical as well. Egocentric means that we're just looking, have a very narrowly defined set of parameters based on who we are. Okay? So, and we see this all the time in children. Children have not yet learned to be egotistical, but they're egocentric. I'm hungry, I want fed. Feed me. I'm dirty, I need changed. Change me. I need love. Love me. They're egocentric. And a lot of times when we come to Scripture, we read Scripture from a very egocentric point of view. We read it from our very narrowly defined parameters. We try and take Scripture and fit it into a scope that we can understand. And that's not necessarily bad, because God knew that when He wrote it, that we were going to do this. And so what I'm going to say today, I am in no way trying to minimize other teachings that you have heard about Palm Sunday. Okay? So I'm not trying to take anything away from those. But what God has really been working with me on the last few years is understanding the depth and the richness of His Word when we don't take it and try and squish it into our culture, but we understand it in light of the culture that was going on. Okay? So, why are we in Exodus? Well, today's Palm Sunday, but what else is today? When Jesus came to Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, it was a unique day in the Jewish calendar. It was the week of Passover, but there was a very specific day. Let's look in Exodus. We're going to go to chapter 12. Flip over there if you would. Okay, we're going to start in verse 1, and let me just give you a little bit of background so you understand where we're starting. The Passover is coming on. The 10th plague is coming on Egypt. God is giving direction to Moses, to Moses and Aaron as to what preparations they need to make. Okay? So, all of the other plagues have happened. Israel has been enslaved for more than 400 years. God has heard their cry from heaven. He's coming down to set them free. He has already begun by bringing plague after plague on Egypt. Pharaoh had his heart hard and would not let him go. So the final plague is coming on. Why? So that God could show that He is the one true God and that no other God has any power over Him. Okay? You want to get into a little bit more of that, come to the Seder dinner, because we explain how each of these plagues that came on Egypt was a direct destruction of one of their gods. How our God, the God that we serve, proved that He was mightier than the pantheon of gods in Egypt mythology. Okay? So, verse 1, the Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall be for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you." This is the month of Nisan. Okay? So keep that in mind. Because God, in creating a new people for Himself, we're seeing the birth of a nation coming out of this. In this process, He is giving them a brand new calendar. He's saying, this is day one. We're starting over right here. Okay, so like this is like the New Year's of New Year's. Okay, this is big stuff. So he says, this will be the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's houses, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for a lamb, then he and his nearest neighbor shall take according to the number of persons, according to what each can eat, you shall make your count for the lambs. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male, a year old. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of the month, when the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill the lambs at twilight. This is important, okay? This is not just one of those logistic things that got stuck in for Israel, because all of the Old Testament sees its fruition in the New Testament. Okay? Everything that God lays out in the Old Testament is working toward an ultimate end. Okay? And part of that end, Winston Churchill said after D-Day, he said, this is not necessarily the beginning of the end, but perhaps it is the end of the beginning. See, the cross was the end of the beginning. Okay? Where Satan thought that he had things under control, things were going his way, he was ruling throughout the world, the Almighty God had a small place that was his, and Satan was making inroads and destroying that by Rome coming in and Hellenistic thinking coming in, and the people of Israel are calling out for a savior, and God answers. But he didn't answer them the way they thought, did he? Okay. So this day, the 10th of Nisan, is called Lamb Selection Day. Okay, so we're going to get a little bit of history here. Okay? Does anybody know what Bethlehem was significant for? Come on, say it out. Well, the birth of Jesus. Yeah, you guys, come on. You said it's true. Of course it's easy. Now the hard one. What else is it known for? What?
Olives.
Yeah. Bread. When Jesus was born, who received the announcement?
Shepherds.
See, that's significant. Because it is believed that Bethlehem was the place that the shepherds raised the sheep and the goats for the sacrifice. And on the 10th of Nisan, they would take the herds of the year-old lambs, and they would bring them up to Jerusalem, and they would bring them in the appropriately named Sheep Gate. And the people would come in, and they would go through, and they would select a lamb. They would choose a lamb for their sacrifice. And then there were 4 days, because we know from the 10th to the 14th, it said on the 10th you select, and on the 14th you will sacrifice. It was the time of inspection. Okay, you checked out the lamb to make sure it was free of blemish, that there was no injury, that it was a worthy sacrifice. Okay, so this day is significant in the Jewish calendar because it's coming up to Passover, which is perhaps the most significant day in the Jewish year, because it's the day that God delivered them out of bondage and made of them a unique people. All right? So Lamb Selection Day is big in the Jewish calendar. And then on the 14th, those lambs would then be sacrificed, the sacrifice for the year for their sins. Okay? So let's jump ahead. We're going to flip all the way over to Matthew. Now, Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry, is actually one of the few events that is recorded in every gospel. Now, I've told you before, when you're taking a class and the teacher repeats him or herself, you make a note. Because if they repeat themselves, it's most likely going to be on the test. It's something that they feel is important and significant. Okay? And so when God gave us the truth of the life of Christ, he didn't do it just in one book. He did it in four. And he gave us four different and unique perspectives. Because each of the authors was writing to a very specific group of people. And yet, there are some stories that are told in one that are not told in others. And yet, this story is told in each gospel. Okay? It's significant. It's important. All right? It's one of those things that we can't afford to look over. Palm Sunday is not just the start of the Easter season for those less liturgical. Okay? This is significant because God is putting a huge marker. If you can imagine the parade, okay, we're all watching a parade and there's the judges stand and the band is coming down and you can hear the band off in the distance. You can hear the tune that's being played off in the distance. That's like God speaking throughout the Hebrew Bible and he's speaking forth prophecies of what's coming. And those throughout history, up to the time of Christ, could hear these things coming. They could hear the band coming. They can't see it. They haven't received it, but they can hear it coming. Well, Palm Sunday, guess what? You can see the band coming. You can see him coming. And then on Good Friday, That band has stopped right in front of the judge's stand, and it's performing. But we are looking forward to the end of the parade. We're looking forward to that time when God brings to completion all that He has promised. Okay, so Palm Sunday, Good Friday, Resurrection Sunday, those are not the end. Those are the end of the beginning part, and God is moving to the end of all things. Okay? So, I'm going to read to you out of the book of Matthew, but what I would like to challenge you this week, read each passage concerning the triumphal entry. Okay? I'm going to bounce back and forth between all of the different versions. I'm going to read out of Matthew, but you need to take a look at Matthew 21. Take a look at Mark chapter 11. Take a look at Luke 19. And take a look at John chapter 12. Okay? Each of those, from the unique perspective of their author, is telling what happened on this day. All right? So predominantly, I'm going to bounce back and forth between Matthew and Luke, but I want you to spend some time in each of those passages, because something's going on here that is much deeper than we really appreciate and realize. All right? So starting in verse 1 of Matthew 21. Now, before I actually get in here, I need to back up a little bit. Because a little while before this, Jesus had taken the disciples and they'd gone up to Caesarea Philippi. And if you look on a map, if you look up to the north of Israel, you see that there's the Sea of Galilee, and you look up a little bit further and you'll see Mount Hermon. And just off to the north and a little bit east of the north part of the Sea of Galilee is Caesarea Philippi. Okay? And Caesarea Philippi has a unique place in geography. It's where the Jordan River is actually born, up in Caesarea Philippi. It comes down, flows into the Sea of Galilee, and then from the Sea of Galilee flows down into the Dead Sea. All right? And there were, from ancient times, it was a very holy place to pagan culture. And it's here that Jesus tells his disciples that upon this rock I will build my kingdom, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now it's significant because there's a cave at Caesarea Philippi that the pagan believers believe took them to the underworld. And so when Jesus is talking to the disciples, they're looking at this pagan place to the underworld, and he's saying the very gates of hell shall not prevail against my church. They have an incredible visual going on here. Okay? And when this was done, after this, he goes up to the Mount of Transfiguration. He comes down, but it says something interesting. He says, in some translations it says, he set his face as flint. In other translations it says, he set his eyes upon Jerusalem. And this is kind of the Jesus has been preparing for these 3.5 years. He's been working up. You know, he's been going through the trials, but now the race has begun. He's running toward that end that he knows is in Jerusalem. And we see from that point on, he starts telling the disciples, and he's telling them, I'm going to Jerusalem to die. And they don't get it. I mean, how many other ways can you interpret that? I'm going to Jerusalem to die. But their minds were not open to this, for two reasons. I think one, because they were still looking for Jesus to bring in the earthly manifestation of the kingdom of God. They had not fully realized what Jesus' purpose in this advent was. Okay? And two, I think God occluded their minds, he clouded their minds, so that they wouldn't try and do something stupid. We know at some points, one point in particular, people were so excited about what Jesus was doing, they were going to take him by force and make him king. Okay? And I think that's part of why their minds weren't so quick to receive. I think God was clouding it, because he had a plan. And his plan was not what they thought. Does God ever work like that in your life? Yes. He has a plan, and it's not what we think. And we were pushing and we're pushing and we're pushing and we're pushing. And it just seems like the door won't open. And finally, he taps you on the shoulder and points to the door across the hall. Oh, maybe I should go this way. Okay, so this is what I think is happening. Okay, they've been up at Caesarea Philippi. He's gone to the Mount of Transfiguration. He sets his face as flint. He makes a conscious decision. I am going here and I will not be turned aside. Okay, now there's a lot of significant things that happen on the road to Jerusalem. We know that he went down to Jericho. That's where he met Zacchaeus. We know that he went over to Bethany. And Lazarus was raised from the dead. So we know there's significant things that are happening. And it's interesting because at Bethany, if you look on a map, you see Jerusalem. And if you draw a line to the west and just a little bit to the south of that, on the other side of the Mount of Olives, there are two villages. There's Bethphage and there's Bethany. And at Bethany was where Lazarus and Mary and Martha lived. And Jesus came in 4 days after Lazarus was buried, and he raised him from the dead. Now, for those of you that don't understand, 4 days is significant to Jewish thinking. Okay? Because they held that the spirit would hover near the body for 3 days. But on the fourth day, the spirit would depart, and that person was good and truly dead. They're not coming back. Okay? And so Jesus waited until Lazarus was good and truly dead to actually come and raise him up. All right? So this is what I'm talking about. You know, we have a certain way of thinking of things, and we miss important points in Scripture because of how narrow our thinking is. Now, I'm not saying that to insult you. I'm here myself. I'm discovering new things all the time. What I'm saying is we need to widen our gaze. Okay? So, here we come. Verse 1, chapter 21. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." Now, before we move on, I want to address a couple things here. Scripture tells us that he stopped at Bethphage. This is important. Okay? Bethphage is exactly one Sabbath's day walk from Jerusalem. Okay, so if you were going to go up to Jerusalem to worship on the Sabbath, you could not be any further away than Bethphage was on the east side of Jerusalem. Okay, so when Jesus stopped there, he's doing it with the peculiar Jewish thinking of a Sabbath day's walk going to Jerusalem. All right, and he sends the two of the apostles ahead of him. Go and get a donkey. This is to fulfill Scripture. Now, Jesus has set his sight on Jerusalem. He knows what's coming. This is the plan that God had made before he created the earth. You gotta believe that in the mind of Christ, who being at one and the same time fully God and fully man, there had to be a war going on. Because as he is fully God, he knows how vital this is for us. And yet as a man, he has got to be considering the cost. As a matter of fact, we know a little bit later when we come to the night at Gethsemane. We know, I love the picture of Jesus praying and weeping because it shows us his humanity. He wasn't God that he just disdained all that was going on, but he was also fully man. And he knew the struggle. And he struggled that night. Okay? So, this is to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion." Does anybody know what Zion is? What's that?
City of David.
The city of David. If you look at Jerusalem, it's actually made up of several mountains. Okay? One of them is Mount Zion, and it's called the City of the Great King. That's the mountain. And keep in mind, their view of mountain is a little different than ours. To us, it would be a large hill. Okay? But that mountain was the city of the king. That's where David put the city of David. All right? So when we read Zion, they're speaking of a mountain, a place, and they're speaking both past tense, where the king was, and future tense, where the ever-reigning king will be. Okay? So Mount Zion sits right below. It's actually connected by a low ridge to Mount Moriah, where the temple of God was and will be. Okay? So say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. Now, I've told you before, but for those that didn't hear, I'm going to repeat this. When Jesus came to Jerusalem, he came on a donkey. This is, again, very significant. Okay, because when a king approached a city, he came in one of two ways. Okay, and the way he approached the city let the people of the city know what his intentions were. The first, what we see here, is coming in on a donkey. He was coming in peace. He was coming in not at war. He was not on war footing. Now, the other way that a king would approach a city was mounted on a horse. And then you got your guard up, because that could very well mean that he's coming for war. And it's significant because when Jesus approaches Jerusalem here, he's approaching on a donkey. He's bringing peace. Okay? But when we see him coming in Revelation, he's coming on a horse. Okay? So again, we need to, there's nothing in here that is insignificant. The smallest part of this is significant because God had a plan. He has a plan, and he's telling us what that plan is. And a lot of times we miss the significant parts because we don't see them as being significant. Okay? So, the disciple went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Now, when I asked you guys about the Mount of Olives, the Mount of Olives is known as that because on the western slope it receives a lot of moisture, and it's good for growing olives. That's pretty descriptive, right? Well, that's the Mount of Olives. I mean, it's like up by Dennis and Jeannie, there's the side of the hill. Swanson's has their grove of apple trees. And you could call that the Hill of Apples. I mean, because that's what's there. And if you go to Jerusalem today, there are still small olive gardens on the Mount of Olives. Okay, so as they're coming down, the people are cutting these palm branches, and they're laying them on the ground in front of them. Some of them are spreading their coats out on the ground. This is a significant thing. It's showing that they recognize that the person that's coming is great. Okay? All right? And so they're spreading these things out on the ground. And the crowd went before him, and that followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, Who is this? And the crowd said, This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. Now, there's a little phrase in here I want to draw your attention to. He says, And the crowd that went before him and that followed him were shouting. Now, you need to understand, when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, Scripture tells us that people that saw that event went forth unto Jerusalem, carrying the message of the miraculous thing that Jesus had done. And so when Jesus is coming, and he comes up over the top of the Mount of Olives, and he begins his descent down into the Valley of Kidron, okay, there were people there waiting for him. They knew he was coming, and they come out of the city to meet him. And yet with Jesus, we know there are a multitude of people. We don't know how many, But it wasn't just the 12 apostles. Because we know later, after Jesus was raised from the dead, we know that there's 120 of them gathered in Jerusalem. Okay? So we don't know exactly how many are coming with them, but we know there's a large number of people following after Jesus. So on the one hand, you have coming out of Jerusalem, these people that were waiting for him. And on the other hand, you have following Jesus, all of the people that came up with him from Bethany. And they're shouting, I think, one to another and in chorus together, Hoshana! Hoshana! Now, Hosanna, how we say it, is actually taken from two Hebrew words. All right, now I got to look at my notes because my Hebrew is not that good. As a matter of fact, it's non-existent. Okay, so the Hebrew word is a compound word. It's from Yasha, which means save us or deliver us, and Yaana, which means I or we beg you, we entreat you, we plead to you. And so what they are saying is, we beg that you would save us. Okay? Now, again, history. We got to interject history here so you understand fully what's going on. Okay? At this time, it is believed that the palm branch, the waving of a palm branch, and the phrase, Hoshana, was illegal inside the walls of Jerusalem. Because these were elements that were used by the zealots. These were symbols of Jewish pride that springs out of the Maccabean revolt some 400 years before, when the Maccabees rose up and Israel rose up and they threw out the Seleucids and the Greeks, and they kicked them out of their country, and they regained for a very brief while their independence. Okay, and two of the symbols that came out of that were the palm branch and the phrase Hoshana, which were actually the zealots used as a war cry. When they would rush in to fight the Romans and to kill the Romans, they would come in yelling, Hoshana. And this is actually out, it's taken from a passage of scripture. It's Psalm 118, verses 25 and 26. It says, save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. Excuse me. That first phrase there, save us, we pray, O Lord, is Hoshana. Okay? And so, as the group is coming down the Mount of Olives, and coming out from Jerusalem are those that are shouting, Hosanna! And those following are echoing, Hosanna! They are a threat to the peace of Jerusalem, because everybody in Jerusalem understands that this man is coming in as somebody big, as a deliverer. And a lot of people had been speaking for years up to this point that Jesus is going to come and he is going to be the one that is going to bring the kingdom of God into Jerusalem and into Israel, and he's going to kick the Romans out, and we're going to celebrate and have a time much like we did under David and Solomon. Okay, this is the thinking of what's going on. Now, understanding this and understanding that the Romans don't like this, because we know from antiquity the Jews were a stiff-necked people. They were very difficult to govern. They did not submit easily to the yoke of slavery. They refused to relinquish their customs, their faith, their traditions, willingly accepting persecution unto death before they would let those things go. Okay? The Romans know this. As a matter of fact, we believe that Pilate was actually sent to Jerusalem as a punishment, because he sided with the wrong guy in the struggle for who would be the next Caesar in Rome. And so he was sent to Jerusalem, not because it was such a great place for a Roman to be, because it was such a horrible place for a Roman leader to be, because nothing good ever came out of it. The Roman, the Jews were too hard to govern. Okay? And so the Pharisees, let's get back to the reading here. I'm sorry, flip over to Luke chapter 19. Okay, now I'm going to pick up in verse 39. Okay, so we kind of ended in Matthew with the people calling out to him. And then in 39, now understanding the political climate of the time. Okay? 39, and some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out." Okay? Now, understanding that they may not just be trying to spite Jesus and say, "You're not worthy of praise," but they're thinking, as a matter of fact, we know from history that not long before this, there was a rebellion that grew up in Jerusalem, and the Romans reacted in such a harsh manner that they went through and they selected a number of people out of the inhabitants of Jerusalem to be killed because of those that rose up against them in Jerusalem. Okay? And they're looking at, they know that Rome rules with an iron fist, and they are worried because the Passover's coming. This is the high day of the year for a festival. And they know that they don't want the Romans to destroy this. They don't want the Romans to interrupt this. Because then it's all going to come to pop. So they're calling out to Jesus, hey, tell these guys to chill. Man, we got Romans back here. And if you guys come into Jerusalem like this, it's going to cause a riot. Okay? And yet Jesus says, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out." I don't think he's speaking allegorically. I think Jesus is just telling a simple truth, that if mankind ever ceases giving God praise, all of creation will call out his praise. Okay? I think, quite honestly, all creation already calls out his praise. All right? But then we have something significant going on here. Okay? Verse 41, "And when he drew near and saw the city, he wept over it." Okay? Now, in the Greek, this wept over it is not just the simple idea that he was just kind of quietly crying and, you know, tear trickled down his cheek. The word here is actually he wailed. Okay? He is wailing in his grief. He is calling out. And it says, he said, "Would that you, even you, had known on this day the things that make for peace. But now they are hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up a barricade around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear you down to the ground, you and your children within you. And they will not leave one stone upon another in you, because you did not know the time of your visitation." Okay, now Jesus is wailing. Now we call this the triumphant entry, and yet Luke makes it very clear that Jesus, when he was coming in, he was wailing. He was crying. He was grieved. Less than 60 years after this, actually about 47 years after this, we see the fall of Jerusalem. And the very thing that Jesus prophesies here happens. Rome comes and they encamp all the way around Jerusalem. They go in and they destroy utterly the capital of Israel. They take the heart out of the Jewish people. Okay? And the Jews as a people at that time ceased to be up until the 1940s. Okay? As a nation, they ceased to be. Okay? So Jesus is seeing in the future, and think about this for a moment. Okay? Think about the heart of God toward us. Here he is. He's coming in the last week of his life. He's looking forward to the cross, the horrific abuse that he knows is coming. And he's not crying for himself. He's crying for them. He's crying because they don't understand what's going on. Here are these people, as a matter of fact, Luke 19, just a little bit before this. Actually, I'm going to flip back verse 11. You don't have to go there. I'll just read it to you. As they heard these things, he proceeded to tell a parable, because he was near to Jerusalem, and because they supposed the kingdom of God was to appear immediately. See, Jesus understands that they're thinking he's going to come in, he's going to oust the Romans, he's going to oust the Jewish leaders, and he's going to set himself up on the throne, and they're going to have this physical earthly kingdom. And yet, Jesus knows that what he's doing is so much more significant than that, and they don't get it. They don't understand what's going on. As a matter of fact, some of them are so ignorant of what's going on. They're so worried that this is what he's going to do. They're not there to support him. They're there to oppose him because they don't want him as a leader. Okay? He's not the Messiah that was promised according to what they understood the Messiah to be. And so they're rejecting him. And it's by that very rejection that God's judgment comes on Jerusalem and on Israel, because they did not know the time of his visitation, that God was there amongst them, and they rejected him. Okay, and so God, in his justice, in his judgment, he destroyed Jerusalem. He took Israel and he uprooted it, and he scattered it all across the world. Okay, but keep in mind, as in all things with God, there's the but God. God had a plan. Okay, now why is this significant? I want to share a couple of thoughts with you here really quick. We started off with the Lamb Selection Day. When Jesus comes down from Bethphage, he actually comes into Jerusalem via the Sheep Gate. The very gate that morning, the lambs from Bethlehem were brought into Jerusalem. And he comes in at the time of the Lamb Selection. And he spends the next 4 days in Jerusalem being questioned by the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, the Herodians, the Greek thinkers. And he's being examined, and he's being cross-examined, and they're checking him out, and they're questioning his doctrine, and they're doing it to challenge, to find if there is flaw in him. At the same time in all Jerusalem, the same thing is happening in every household, because they're checking the lambs to make sure the lamb is unblemished. Now, this is the only time that we see in all of the Gospels that Jesus comes into to Jerusalem receiving the praise that he is due and not telling people to be quiet. Not telling them, don't tell anyone what I've done. He comes in and he receives their praise and even tells the Pharisees, hey, you can't stop this. All right? This is important because he's coming in as the Lamb selected by God to pay the price, to be the sacrifice for all mankind. He is submitting himself for inspection by all of those who would have a determination into whether or not he was an appropriate sacrifice. And after all they've done, they can find nothing wrong with him. Over and over again, you'd think they would learn. Every time we question him, he makes us look stupid. Well, let's think of a better question. Was it right to give Caesar our taxes? Well, they thought they were going to get him good with that one, because if he says yes, all the Jews will oppose him. They'll abandon him. If he says no, we hand him over to the Romans as a rebel. What does he say? Well, let me see the coin that you pay the tax with. They give it to him, and he holds it up, and he says, well, whose picture and whose inscription is on this coin? Well, Caesar. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's. And give to God what is God's. And I think, man, he just zap. So they got to go back to their bosses. Ah, got us again. Well, how can we get him? Let's get another one. You know, you would think they would learn. But they didn't. They didn't learn. Okay? Honestly, thank God they didn't learn. Because if they had learned, the entire course of history would be different, and we would still yet be in need of an ultimate sacrifice. Okay? So, Lamb Selection Day, 10th of December. Jesus comes in to Jerusalem. He comes in as a king, bringing peace. He comes in, I mean, he's right, he tells them, if you had known what would bring you peace, he's coming on a donkey. And they don't understand what he's telling them. And he comes in and he submits himself to their investigation, to their checking him out and looking to see if there's any flaw, and they can find none. And these aren't even people that want him as, I mean, when you get a lamb, you go and you purchase a lamb, you're hoping that there is nothing wrong with this lamb. They're not even doing that. They don't want him as the lamb. And yet they still can't find anything. He still passes their inspection. So Palm Sunday, let's get a little bit of Western thinking out of the way and some Eastern thinking coming in here. Because there's so much more going on here than what we realize. Because back when God made a nation out of the people of Israel, he knew this was a foreshadow of what was to come at Calvary. And he sets up for them these prophecies that they're looking at as these are just commands, these are laws. But they're prophecies speaking forth of what's to come. That God has said, this is the way to be holy. This is the way to be righteous. And these are the steps you need to take, but I'm going to fulfill all of those. And I'm going to make a way that the sacrifices I require of you will be paid once and for all, will be done over with. Okay? And yet they don't understand. They're not understanding what his word is saying. And I want us to be a people of understanding. I want us to be a people that look beyond the surface value of what's being read there. I want us to read with minds like sponges that suck and absorb everything that God has for us. I want us to be a people that read with understanding, that take the time to devote ourselves to understanding his word. I guarantee you, you will never dig to the bottom of God's word. The deeper you go, the richer it gets, but you'll never get to the bottom. Okay? Father, we thank you. Lord God, oh. God, as we enter into the Passion Week, the lamb has been brought forth to be inspected, to verify that it is pure, without blemish. The lamb has gone willingly to slaughter. God, we thank you. Father, teach us the full depth of desperation. Being so desperate for a solution that there was no answer to until the cross. God, that we might worship and praise you more for understanding the depth, the heights, the richness of what you've done for us. God, that our hearts would be turned to you, that our minds would be stayed on you. Father, this week as we move toward remembering on Friday, rejoicing on Sunday, help us to not be distracted by the noise that the world throws at us. Father, help us to be steadfast in seeking you and dwelling with you. Father, let us be a people that pleases you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.